used to live there.
No. We need to be followed.
Yeah, exactly.
That one.
I will celebrate when once I'm there.
Yeah.
That's for sure.
I get it. I don't want to change it.
It's the math school, there's a lot of.
It's studio, it's more like a studio, not a room.
Lazy.
Very nice.
Yes, it's like 6 minutes away from here.
Perfect, yeah.
Right.
I'll marry like Chantal again.
This can be no.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But like Chantal said, that.
It feels the same level, so.
Yeah, but.
Yeah.
Yeah, right, yeah. Tiny fridge.
Yeah, I love that.
Thank you for coming down. You also know them?
Yeah.
I hope so.
Yeah. Wow. And that your mom uses that packet? It's so good.
Right.
Wow. Well,
I had a dream where they tried to sell me something like this, but with a kitchenette, a real kitchen. For 700.
That was exactly the second.
It's a hustle.
Are they nice?
Yeah, they're elderly.
No, no, we're going to be. Yeah. I meant swag. Pass from the top. I can't be echt nodig, maar het is meestal.
Ik kan ook zo goed
which is like for. But I already accepted this, you know, just to
no,
make sure.
Sorry.
Hey!
To get like peers, so to do the house.
You
gotta
repeat.
Yes. So it's cheaper, but. I might not get it, you know, because I guess they're interviewing several people at the same time. And I didn't get any of this, so it's better.
It's lovely.
It's very lovely.
So, I
should work out over.
Well, that's a good idea. Not too much, like 10 minutes by bike.
Yeah.
This is closer.
It's hope. We got the
problem. But then it's like
for an
extra.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah.
It's more.
Yeah, how come they have tools and I think
they're
but you know people are social.
Now, stel dat ik het nodig heb, dan.
Yeah.
In the long term, it's gonna be.
Komen er wel uit.
Yeah. I think
and
it's
also altijd
things.
Is er
online that it might be interesting, so.
Als je het niet takes.
Ja, nou ik heb, sterker nog, ik heb een iPad hierbij.
Ja.
Ik kan hem koppelen aan mijn dingen, maar mijn omdat ik hem een tijdje niet heb gebruikt, is mijn pen leeg. Dus ik dacht dat ik het zo kon zetten dat ik eigenlijk hier in de buurt was. Dus ik had moeten checken, maar dat heb ik niet meer gedaan. Maar oké, we komen er wel uit, we komen er wel uit.
Ik
kom er altijd uit, dus.
Yeah.
Sorry.
It's actually nice. And then when you do like, force yourself.
I know.
You do miss it, actually.
He's funky.
Yeah.
Like, oh no, that's not good.
Okay, before we start, just to inform how are things going with the course? Is there already stress for the exam?
Definitely.
To categorize that, a healthy stress or a unhealthy stress? Something like in between? Yeah? So this means that you are in the right place. If you were not stressed, that means you are probably got to put it on the positive system. It's a positive thing, right? So the other thing is, I saw some conversations, also I followed them. What's happening here about the exam. It is indeed true that Frans this year is his first time that he will give this course. It's similar to what I do in that sense, we always agree. But he might put some more effort or more essence on some of the other topics than I do. So that's why it might be a little bit different. But I think that the old exam will be quite reasonably in that direction. But don't be surprised if the type of questions might be a little bit different. Yeah? But I think on the level of difficulty, it will be similar. Okay, we just have to wait until a quarter past. I see that three people are live. Maybe already people here in this room. I don't know.
It still works.
It does. To which one are you connected?
You.
Alright, it's not working. I'll do it again.
Yeah,
Ik
Ah, this is the movie effect. If the lights go down, people. What is best? Is it okay like this? Or this? That's fine. Okay. Okay, let us start. Well, normally I would say welcome everybody if I see you for the first time, but I've already seen you in the first week, of course. The plan is basically that I am giving a lecture here, and Frans will give a lecture at this moment now in the at the advanced course, just to hear the same topic more or less again from another person. Of course, I will go in some other details, as Frans will go in other details in the other lecture. So, what we want to discuss, I saw that Frans already took, invested 2 days in generalized linear models, and it's considered always one of the more difficult topics. And the reason is that, well, this picture here, and I have to remember that I have to put my my cursor here, to move my cursor here because of people online. If you should look at this picture, then you already see several things. These are data that need to be analyzed with a generalized linear model. And maybe on first sight you already see that there's some non-linearity. And you might think, well, that's a little bit strange, right? We talk about linear models. Well, the linear model part is actually, if we look fundamentally to it, it's the equation that we use. So if the equation only make use of minus and plus and multiplication, then more or less we are in the linear regime. We are just plus, and then some things that could be a factor or could be a slope times a concentration. Then we are in the linear regime, because every time something happens, something is added to each other. So if that's not the case, for instance, we have this interaction term, but we also add that interaction term. So we have just very simple additive building blocks. And that's the idea of a linear model. Why is that so important? Because that makes it so easy to interpret. If you have an interaction, for instance, if you look at Yankova, in Yankova we saw that there is a factor and there is a numerical explanatory variables. You get you get these different slopes and different intercepts. And that differences in intercepts and slopes is accounted for by the interaction term. Yeah? But that's just a term that is added. It's just plus and then the interaction term. So in statistics and actually in science, we really like these models because they're so simple to give an interpretation to. Yes, there is an effect on the intercept. Or no, there's no effect on the intercept. Yes, there is an effect on the slope. No, there is no effect of the slope. There is a slope. There is an effect of the numerical. So it's, you can actually talk about these elements independently of each other. That's nice. Because at the moment that there is interaction, where normally non-linearity occurs, then interpretation becomes much more tedious and much more difficult. So in a lot of experimental designs, you try to be in a certain range where there's linear behavior. So again, if we look at this plot, we see the lowest trace is almost linear, or it's linear, it's a straight line. And maybe, I don't know if Frans told you, you have this gray area. Every line that can run through this straight, through this gray area, is statistically speaking not distinguishable from that line. Yeah, they're therefore statistically similar. Yeah? So, in that sense, it works fine. However, here, we see that we get much more deviations from it. It's, I cannot argue that I can draw a straight line through these, this gray area. So every straight line that I want to draw through this region of points is statistically different from that curved line. But how can we get that curved line if we have linear models? And if we have this generalized linear models, which include linear models in its name. And that, of course, has everything to do with the transformation that occur when we use generalized linear model. When do we want to use a generalized linear model? For several reasons. For instance, when we have a normal linear model, we assume this assumption of normality, of heterogeneity, of variance. Important assumptions that we need to check. And we run the model. If you look at it, basically running the model, running, calculating your statistics is peanuts. Yeah, you run your model and you say summary and then you have everything and then you're back in biology again because you have to interpret it. But most of the work is actually looking at the quality of your data and looking at the assumptions that are met. And that's why it's the case like that, because these diagnostics of the data and the model need to be done in order to check the reliability of your model. If the assumptions are not correct, or if your data is not in order, then the assumptions that you extract from a statistical model might not be reliable. That's the case. If I would draw a linear line through the upper line, that would not be reliable, because we clearly can see that it's a curved line. Yeah? So therefore, it's very important that we take that into account. Now, when will we use that, for instance? Already, when we have counts. Counts are typically discrete. Counts never are, in theory at least, in practical theory, never are negative. Yeah, they're always positive. You start with zero and then you go to infinity. And they might have a different distribution, and that's actually the case. Things like waiting times, if you have whole number, you count the time that you have been served in a line, or you count the time that the bird returns to its nest, that typically has a Poisson distribution. We could say that at a certain point, Poisson distribution is very similar to a normal distribution, but at the moment that the expected counts that you would expect are low, so below say 10 or 15, then you get this strange nonlinear behavior. And this is due to the asymmetry of the Poisson distribution. Because before we always assumed this normal distribution, that's nicely symmetrical, then you get a straight line. And if it's not the case, if it's asymmetrical, then you get these curved lines. A similar thing we observed if we do, for instance, the binomial GLM. Binomial GLM, we can also do it in counts. We count the number of successes. For instance, you have 20 measurements and you just count how many times you have a success. And success could be the absence or the presence of a certain object, or life or death, or, well, success or failure, these type of things. Yeah. So there we know that there is also a maximum, the number of trials that you do. And it means that there are counts, but these number of counts cannot go to infinity. They can go to just the number of trials that you want to see if there's success or failure. And then you get the binomial. And it turns out that they all belong to a certain family, which is the exponential family, which is basically the foundation of this generalized linear model. Because the generalization goes from linear models that can only do a normal distribution to a generalization that it can fit also distributions from the exponential family, as we will see, and as probably has been discussed already. Okay, so these are the assumptions that we normally look at. So we have some response variable, we have some fixed part, and some random part. This random part will be discussed in more detail in advanced statistics. But anyway, whatever this model will be, for instance, the random part could also be the residuals. Yeah, residuals is also a random part. These are the assumptions that we basically make. One of them is also, maybe it's that it's not discussed, the correct model specification. That's why we, in model selection, we want to have the best model that fits the data best. I heard an echo of myself. So I stream to the next door. Yeah. So basically what we want to do with GLM is that to see if one of these assumptions is not met, we could actually deal with that in some cases with the GLM. Now, that's normally when we say the residual follows a normal distribution. If that's not abided to, because for instance, in this case it's a Poisson, then we do a GLM. For instance, variances of all treatments are equal. It's actually also true for Poisson distribution, as we will see. And that will introduce this concept of overdispersion and things like that. Yeah. So it's also dealt with a GLM. Okay, the linear relationship is still there. However, the geometric linear relationship, as we saw before, has gone. Okay, let's proceed. This you already have discussed, eh? You have discussed the Poisson distribution with Frans? Yes? So I can skip this basically. Here, this is maybe good to see that if the lambda, so the expectation value of the amount of counts is higher, then you see that it becomes really a symmetrical distribution. And if I would only draw the line, then you could argue that it would be a normal distribution. The point is that it has returned to a symmetric distribution. Whereas here, this tail is just a little bit longer. It means that there is higher probability in the tails. Yeah? And here, of course, you see this stronger asymmetry related to a smaller expectation value if you expect, say, 5 returns to the nest of the bird. Okay, working with counts and transformations. Did you discuss transformations with Frans? Yes? Okay. So let's look at the experiment that we want to have a view on. The effect of chloride channel blockers on the depolarization of spikes. Now, if you have electrophysiology, for instance, electrophysiology, especially for excitable cells like muscle cells and neurons, they have to be stable in the sense that it should not start firing an exipotential train with the result that you get muscle contraction or you get some brain signals. So you only want to have that on the controlled situation, so the membrane must be stable. The stability of the membranes in some cells is accounted for by the chloride potential and therefore chloride channels. There's not so much a potential over the membrane for chloride, it's only for potassium and sodium, but chloride has a sort of damping effect. Yeah? And if you start blocking these chloride channels, it turns out that these spikes will become more chaotic. So you have sometimes spiking behavior in the muscle or in the brain that's just started without any, you know, signal from another cell. Yeah, so this is something that you don't want. And there are some diseases, for instance, in muscle that has this problem that these chloride channels do not work very correctly. Yeah. So these blocking, we want to do some research. If we put these different blockers to it, when these blockers have different affinity and different mechanisms to block the chloride at different concentration, how many spikes do I see at this randomly occurring train of spikes? Yeah, that's the idea. So we count these number of spikes. The problem with these spikes is there are not really 30 of these spikes, there are normally maybe 1 or 3 or 4 or 5 or 10. So you might already expect that the number of spikes might not be that enormously big, in theory at least. Okay, so one thing to also take into account that when we do normal generalized models, we actually fit using minimizing the least the residual sum of squares. So basically this line is not a good fit and the blue line is a good fit just by the assumption, just by the rule that the sum of all the residuals of the values around the fitted line would be minimized. That's a very simple computational task and that can be done by hand. Yeah. If you don't have a lot of these points, then you can easily do it by hand. GLM, however, will use maximum likelihood. And one of the reasons of the assumptions of homogeneity of variance is due to this method. This method actually assumes homogeneity of variance. Yeah? Okay, so let's run a normal model. So we have a linear model. And we have a linear model here. So we have counts, that's response variable, the number of spikes, the different treatment, the concentration of the treatment, and the possible interaction term. We don't know, but we add this interaction term because we can always take it out, but first we want to check if it has some relevance in our data model. Now we look at the result, we observe already two things. This looks a little bit heterogeneous. You see that control has a lower variance, smaller variance than, for instance, ASFT treatment or the other treatment. And the other treatment has the highest variance. We also see that there is quite some non-linear residual residual non-linearity here going on. Yeah. So this is of course why we do these diagnostics, to see that we have these two problems, heteroscedasticity, and we have this non-linearity occurring. And if we look at the test for non-linearity, which you get automatically if you do residual plots model, then you see that it's highly significant. So there's a real non-linear behavior going on in our data. So this would be a little bit awkward to proceed now with a linear model. Yeah. If we do the non-constant variance test, we actually see that that's the case. Now, if we go back and we look at the distribution here, we also observe that this lambda, when it is increasing, the expectation value, basically the mean, yeah, if it's increasing, then you also see that the variance of the distribution is increasing. You can, of course, see it because it becomes wider. And the other part you can see it clearly is that the tip, the highest point, becomes lower, because in the end, the surface area under the distribution will always be one. Yeah? You can clearly see with increased expectation values, you get wider distributions. And that is, of course, also what we saw. The most biggest curve that we observed is also the one that has the highest variance that we observe. And that's exactly what we observed before. Yeah? So we have several indications. First of all, we have an indication that this might be Poisson but not normal because of counts. But we know that if the expectation value is high for the counts, then it might behave like normal. But now, doing the diagnostics, we can clearly see, nope, we really have to do this GLM because we have to take into account this heterogeneity. That's one. And two, we have to automatically take into account this nonlinearity. Yeah? Okay, so remember that here, if we look at this, we also see some more extreme points here. So if we were rather naive, we would proceed with this analysis. We would have taken maybe these points out. They might have big Cook's distance. You might think, okay, this curve runs like this because of this point. That point is a sort of an attractor. It wants to attract the expectation value at that point. Yeah, so you will probably be doing wrong stuff, taking out observations that are not really, you should not really take them out. Yeah? Okay. So this is already done. We can do the QQ plot. We see already also here maybe the outlier, maybe it's that one. But this is, it looks rather okay. It's not so bad. You know, it's not that it's, you do get some curvature here. What I would actually expect in this case would be that it would go up here a little bit more. It would be more like a banana. So you have here the straight line, and the data of a Poisson normally runs like this. Now, we don't have an indication here. So it's clearly we don't see it everywhere, but we have enough indication to start worrying about this. Yeah. If we do a Boxcox transformation, if we want to see, okay, if we want to do a transformation, what would be a good power transformation? Then this one would suggest something around a half, something like a square root. Yeah, the power to a half is a square root. Okay, we could do something like that. And if we run this square cube root transformation in this case, yeah, if I do the cube root transformation, indeed I observe that I have homogeneity of variance, but now I get these extreme points, even more extreme points. These 48 and 40, and I still have this problem of heterogeneity of variance. Yeah? It's less, but still there. And you might argue, well, it's there because of these outliers, these extreme points. If I would take out these outliers, everything would be okay. Okay. So you go further and further down the rabbit hole. And of course, here you would be motivated even more to get into these extreme values, take them out. Now, assume that you say, okay, this is indeed not the right method to use. Let's start using GLMs. Let's see what happens then. The GLM model, yeah, is basically consisting of a linear equation. This is basically the LM in the GLM, is the linear model, is the linear equation. You see it here. is just a sum. Only the intercept is on its own. It's only the value, because there the x value is zero, so you don't need to make that explicit. And the other ones can be vectors or can be slopes or whatever. Yeah. So these are is the linear equation that we are used to. The only thing that we see, we don't add this residual idea behind it. Normally we have the linear equation, and we said, okay, if we put it in R, we don't put the residuals there, because there are always residuals. Otherwise, we don't do. There's no need to do any statistics, because due to the first week, due to the residuals, we have statistics. But these the residuals have their own function here. They are decoupled from the linear equation in the sense that we have to say something about the distribution of these residuals and to see if they belong to the exponential family. And if you want to do a GLM, it has to be of the exponential family. And then we need a function to link them together again. So now I have my linear model separately from my residuals, and now I have to link them together. Yeah. And this link, in the end, is the reason why the residuals start to behave like a normal distribution again. So that's the trick. So normally we have this transformation we do of the response variable, and as a result, the residuals start to behave like normal again. Yeah. But now we start to basically transform our model, our linear model, and as a result of that, our results, the residuals become normal again. So we have to check afterwards again if it's things are normal. So by doing so, we actually get in the same regime as we are used to in with linear model, just by the fact that we have this distribution family and the link function. That makes basically the generalized linear model. Now, Frans told you about the exponential family? Yes? Yeah, basically there's an equation, and if the mathematical equation of the distribution, the Poisson, the binomial or gamma, can be transformed continuously in such a way, then it's an exponential family. Now, in advanced statistics, we go in a little bit more deeper in what that actually means, but that makes them the family member of the family. Yeah. This you probably already have, so I go through them quickly. So you can have the normal distribution, the Poisson distribution, binomial distribution. You also have others, but these are the more common ones in biology, where we have different link functions, the log, the square root of identity. Identity basically is a sort of a power relation, but to the power one. So it doesn't really do anything, doesn't really change anything. And you can also have the normal distribution, because that's also part of the exponential family, and that's also identity. Nothing happens, no transformation of your model. Yeah. And logit and probit for the binomial. You don't have an identity there. Actually, you also have a log function for the normal distribution. If you have a log normal distribution, you can also fit it in that way. Okay. The thing that is important here is that we don't use in this method this ordinary least square, so minimizing of the means, the sum of squares of the residuals, but we use maximum likelihood. It's a method that basically fits the distribution, that finds try to fit it from a distribution point of view, not from a geometry and then a residuals. Yeah, and this maximum likelihood method is less sensitive to the assumption of homogeneity of variance. That's the second part. So it means this assumption of homogeneity of variance is less strict. Okay. Of course, very extreme situations need to be dealt with, but it can deal with quite some range of that. Okay, now in R, how does R work? Well, basically, if you use a different method, you have a different function. And of course, you want to have a function that makes some sense. Therefore, we have the GLM function for a generalized linear model. This G basically assumes that we add additional arguments between the brackets, and that argument must be the link function, because we need now to link the exponential family to the linear equation. So this is the linear equation. This part is the linear equation. and we use it as before, nothing has changed. So the coding of your hypothesis, basically, because you code your hypothesis here in a statistical model, is the same as a linear model. The only thing is there is an extension, and that extension has to be, in this case, because we are looking at the Poisson problem, a Poisson link function, and the link function that I choose is log, and I also choose the link function square root, just in order to see which one will fit best. Because normally we don't know exactly which one will be best. We hope for good reason, that will be explained in this lecture, that it would be the log transformation, that's the transformation that can actually work for your data, because we know its behavior. Because if you do a transformation of your data, then your model will change. For instance, if you look at the slope and you took the log transformation of the response variable, so the log transformation of y, and then you still have x, then the slope is not y divided by x, like kilometer per seconds, but it would be log kilometer per seconds, which makes actually no sense. Yeah? So you have to, that's one of the problems that you have. So if you do a transformation here also, then it means that your slope and your intercept would get a different meaning. But here the meaning, because we are transforming the model, makes sense. Yeah, as we will see. Yeah? Okay. So here the three elements are here. The error structure and the link function is given explicitly. Now, the first thing we do, of course, when we run a model, is looking at the diagnostics. Because we have to check, was this a good step? Or are there some other problems? And if we look at the diagnostics, first of all, we see that this blue line nicely follows the fitted line. So it means that it has a linear relationship. The residuals have a linear relationship, because now we look at the residuals. Remember, we look at the residuals. The residuals have a linear relationship with our model. Yeah? This is what we want. We also see that the variance is much more homogeneous. We don't see these extreme values like 40 and 52. Yeah? And we see homogeneity of variance also on the factor level. So in one step, we have solved these problems by using the correct method with the correct model. Yeah? So you see here that this method in this case is preferred over the transformation of the response variable, which created all these strange extreme values. Yeah? So in that sense, you could say that looking at the assumptions by looking at the model diagnostics will also give you an idea which model is the best model. And actually with GLMs, we have some other elements that can tell us if this is the correct model. Of course, we have looked at the QQ plot, and we see that it's nicely normally distributed. Now, it was already nicely normally distributed, we saw. Well, at least this, if you compare the two, this is a little bit better than the other one. And if you look at the Shapiro test p-value will also be bigger. So it means that the deviation from normality is also smaller because we have the same number of observations here. Yeah. So clearly this GLM gives us a better fit. Now, this plot didn't fit really well on my sheet. And it's due to these warning messages, which are not important, by the way. It just means that it was... last time it was checked, it was built on this version, yeah, which is not the version that I used when I run this this code. But this is, do I have another one? Yeah, here. Basically, this is the curve. So you see here, let's talk about this right away. The blue curve is the log link function, and the dashed curve, the dotted curve, is the square root link function. You see that the one fits better than the other, and we have to decide which one is the better fit. We also see that basically this dashed line is within the gray area, so they are significantly not different. Yeah. So in that sense, we could use them both, but maybe one can be a little bit better than the other, and we will see how to deal with that also in this lecture. Yeah? Okay. So we have checked the assumptions. Now look at the output. Now this is the output of the generalized linear model. You probably made some assignments in there yet, and you know already, you have seen the differences. Now the biggest difference is the use of deviance instead of just residuals, standardized residuals. Another difference is that instead of the t value, we have here z value. Is it explained what the z value is? That actually is? Huh? Yes? Or? The z value.
But isn't it like
the it's like the t value. Like the t value. Okay, so because we make this assumption, well, if you do a test, if you compare two expectation values, you can do the t-test, right? And you do the t-test at the moment if you don't know the variance and standard deviation of your data. That's normally the case if you have a t-test, because you just sample. From your sample, you can derive your standard deviation. So that's why you use the t-test, because it has these little bit more uncertainties in the tails. I will not go more deeper into that. But if you have a lot of degrees of freedom, meaning a lot of observations, then the t-distributions become basically the standard normal distribution. And the standard normal distribution is a normal distribution with expectation value of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. Yeah, that's the standard normal distribution. And the score of the standard normal distribution is the z-score. And the z-score, or the z-test you do, if you compare two means, for instance, and you know already in advance what the variance would be. Before you start sampling, you know already, this is the variance that, and this is the variance that we use. Now there might be theoretical reasons for that. Then you can use the z-score. I can imagine that in biology it is almost never the case. However, because of this strange behavior, this strange property of the binomial, but also the Poisson distribution, that the expectation value, lambda, is a value for the expectation of the mean, the expectation value, or the how many counts you would expect, and at the same time, it's the variance. So once you fit and fixed the mean, you already know the variance. So it means that you don't need to calculate the variance. And then you go to the z-score, to the standard normal distribution. And that turns out to be an important thing. Because if they are fixed, and it turns out that your data have a bigger variance than you would theoretically expect from the expectation value, then your model doesn't fit well. If you have a normal distribution, you can solve that easily, because then you can just change the variance, because there the variance is independent of the mean. Yeah? And this is also why we saw in that picture that if you have small expectation values, you had small variance, and if there's an increase in expectation value, you get a higher variance. They are just linked one to one. Therefore, knowing the mean, you know the variance is fixed, and we get the z-score. And it's the same thing for the binomial. Now, this only basically matters if you don't have a lot of data points. If you have a lot of data points, then they are basically the same. You also calculate them the same. It's just this value minus 0, so just this value, divided by the standard error, will give you the z-score. And from the z-score, like the t-distribution, you go to the z-distribution, the standard normal distribution, and you calculate the p-value. Okay, so in that sense, it's different, but very much the same in interpretation and everything. Then here, you have the null deviance and the residual deviance. And here it becomes interesting and really different. For instance, if you have a normal linear regression, you would have there something like the residual r-squared, yeah, of the maximum the residual r squared, yeah, multiple r squared, which is a value for the amount of variance that is explained by your model. The bigger it is, yeah, if it would be 1, then you would have a 100% explanation of your data. Then you have been overfitting, you have a saturated model. Think of the things I explained in the first week. If it's lower, It means that there's more residuals and that your model does not explain all the different data points. And normally you will, of course, be quite some distance away from one. Yeah. Now here we don't have such a thing, but the information is there because the null deviance, and deviance is just another word for variance. Actually, the deviance is the same as the sum of squares. Yeah. The sum of squares, the size of how much the observations deviates from the mean, the expectation value squared. So this is the maximum variance that could be explained now in terms of deviance, but it has the same meaning. This is what is left after the model has been run, the size of your residuals. So if I would ask you how much is explained, how much deviance is explained by this model, could you calculate that from this?
The first one minus the second one?
Yeah. Yeah. So if you have this one and you subtract this one, that what is left basically has been explained by the model. Now if you want to know the percentages to get something more like the multiple R squared, you just take this value, subtract this value, and divide by the maximum amount. You normalize to the maximum amount. If this would be zero, then of course you get the perfect fit. Makes sense, because if the residual deviance, the residual deviance would be zero, it means that you have a perfect fit because every point has been fitted, then of course this should be one. Yeah, so in that way you can extract it. Another even more important one is that under the assumption that you have a good fit, if you have a good fit in terms of a Poisson distribution, means that doesn't mean that you have fitted all the data, that you have 100% fit. No, it means that the expectation value is the same as the residual standard deviation or variance. Then you have a good fit. Because then the residuals follows a nice distribution that is transformed from a Poisson distribution, and we know that these are linked to each other, the expectation value and the variance. And we can check that by, if this residual variance is the same value as the degrees of freedom, that's basically the test that you do, then you have a good fit. Now you have two options. The value 66, the residual value could be smaller or bigger than the 66. If it's bigger, we talk about over dispersion. It means that there's more dispersion, more variance in your residual. So your model did not explain all the variance that it could explain. Or it's smaller, you have under dispersion, then your model has been explaining too much. You start overfitting. You start to fit random behavior. And you don't want to fit random behavior, you want to fit systematic behavior. Yeah? Okay, and the last one, the Fisher score, will tell you a little bit how fast the algorithm moved to its best fit. If it's only a few steps, it means it's very stable, you get a stable result. If that becomes bigger, so it goes to 10 or 15, it means it has some difficulty to find a good fit for your model. It means that is you have a sort of an unstable fit. So your model becomes less reliable in terms of interpretation. Okay, all these steps I explain in the next few sheets, so I go through them a little bit quickly. But the other things I have to note is that these things, like this, the concentration, which is the slope, basically, of the intercept, which is in the intercept, is the control, then the first one here, concentration, is the slope of the control. Yeah. We see that we have a slope, and from a slope we know that we have a straight line. A slope gives us a straight line. Yeah. But we saw in the graph that we have a curve. So how are they related? How can a slope creating a straight line basically creates a curve that has infinite numbers of tangent lines or slopes to fit at different points? Yeah? And that means, that turns out that we have to give this a different interpretation, otherwise I cannot link this slope to the curvature that we observed. Yeah? Okay, let's proceed. Now, this is basically the way for Poisson how to calculate the deviance. And if you look at it for a while, you see, okay, here I have the mean, and I look at the difference between the mean and the individual observations. Well, that's exactly what you do also do with the sum of squares. So in this equation, you do see some of the sum of squares equation, right? So the sum of the individual minus the mean squared, yeah? We also have this sum, of course, but now we have this logarithm here, natural logarithm, and a ratio. So we get a sort of a strange sum of squares, in this case, specially designed for the Poisson distribution, which can be just equated to the sum of squares. And it will be the same as the sum of squares if the expectation value is a little bit bigger. Yeah. Okay, and this is needed for extracted from the maximum likelihood. Now, this is also what we already discussed, so we can skip this. But now, let's look at the regression table. We already observed that this is just a mean slope, which would be a straight line, but we observe this curve. How can they be related? Now, we know that our model was log transformed because we used this log transformation, yeah, this log-link function. So if I want to go back, how do you go back from a log to normal? Using an exponential, yeah? So you take the exponent of our model, which means that our these values here, the intercepts and the different slopes, yeah, they are also exponents. So if I want to take them back, if I want to know what actually these exponents are, I need to, of these log transformed parameters are, I need to transform them back. Let's do that. Now remember here the two values. I will look at the situation of the slope of this treatment. Yeah? I don't look at this one, but at this one. So what is the slope of that treatment? The real slope. This is the difference between the slope of this treatment, ASFT, compared to the slope of control. Yeah? So that's the difference. So if I want to know the slope itself for ASFT, I have to add them together. Yeah? Okay. This is what I do here. Slope fitted for the control plus the slope fitted for the difference between the two slopes of the other treatment of ASFT. And I take the exponent. And then I get this number. This number means that if I change one unit of concentration, being nanomolar or millimolar or whatever, if I change one unit, I get an increase in the tangent line, basically the slope at that point, of 30%. So I get a 30% increase in how fast the relation between the concentration and the number of spikes will increase. You see that 30% is positive, it's bigger, right? So basically one means, if this would be one, so 100, it means I could have a straight line, because that would be just a straight line. So every time I get an increase of the same order of magnitudes, yeah, always one. But if I have 1.30, I will get the previous slope plus 30%, plus 30%, plus 30%. So it goes steeper, 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 and this is exactly what we observed. So this 30%, basically, everything bigger than one in this case, means that that's the rate of the change of the tangent line on the curve. So it's the rate of change. So this is basically how to give an interpretation. So it means also, if you are at higher concentrations and you make a step, then the change of the number of spikes will increase faster than at lower concentrations. Yeah? So there's a sort of an increase, and that's exactly the nonlinearity that we observed. Now, it could also happen that this would be, say, 0.70. If it's 0.70, then you get a decrease in every step of 30%. And then you have a curve that starts decreasing. And indeed, in the middle, you have a straight line. Now, if you would take the exponent only from 0.1, from the control, then you see that you get a very small percentage. You get something like 1.05 or something. So you get only a minute curvature. And this is also what we saw in the curve. The highest curve was given by FGST, yeah? And then we have to add 21 to 10. And if we take the exponent from that, that would even be more. So it would be in higher, would be something like 1.60 or so. And then it would go even higher and steeper, just more curvature. That's exactly what we observe, yes?
How is the 30.2% calculated again?
So the calculation is done by, this is for the slope then, by calculating the slope related to the curve of this treatment of ASFT, yeah? And you can do that by just taking this value and add this value, yeah? Then you take the exponent, and then you get that number, yeah? So the closer the exponent is to zero, yeah, the more you have a straight line. If it's negative, then you get a decrease. If it's positive, you get an increase of the these values. Yeah? Makes sense? I see on your face that it does not really make it.
Lands on 1.3 value is obtained from the calculation.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So if you have a one step, you go from say concentration 2 to 3, and then the step that you make in that direction is just the same amount as the previous step. So you have the previous step, you go up 3, and the next step you go up 3, and the next step you go up 3. So every time you make one unit of concentration, you go 3 up. Every time, so you get 3 times 1, yeah? What will happen if you now you don't have 3 times 1, that you every time you have 3 steps up because you have a slope of 3 or something like that, but now you go 3 steps times 1.3 up. Then you get a 30% increase every time. Increase every time, increase. This, yeah? So, this is basically what I calculated here. I do it basically by calculating the tangent line, and I will show that in the picture in the next slide. Let's look at this right away. So I basically calculate the tangent line here and the tangent line there. And if I round it a little bit, then I could say I could also take the tangent line in the middle. Yeah. If I do that in this calculation, and here I actually do the calculation by calculating the value at that point, because the curvature, the tangent line from a exponent function is directly related to the value of that point, in this case the value of the model. So here you have the intercept, yeah, and the addition of the intercept due to the treatment. So remember these two numbers, they are just basically this number plus this number plus this number, then I get the intercept of ASF, and then this number, I get the slope. Yeah, so you have this number and this number, I get the intercept of ASF, this number and this number, I get the slope, times 4, which is the concentration that I'm looking at the moment, and I do the same thing for 5, then I get these two numbers, and if I take the ratio between them, I get exactly the same thing. Yeah. I get this increase of 30%. And that's what you see here. We have this tangent line that just will increase in steepness, yeah, with the increase of the concentration. And the speed that it does, that's basically given by this 30%, is the rate of change. So the bigger this 30% would be, the bigger the value is, bigger than 1, the higher you get at the steeper it starts to move. The closer it gets to one, the rate of change, then it becomes just straight. If the rate of change, so the exponential of these values, becomes smaller, then you get a decrease. Yeah? So already if you see, knowing the exponential, if you have a negative exponential, then you get numbers smaller than one. Because if you visualize the exponential, it goes up from negative values, then it crosses the y-axis at one, and then it goes up again. So every positive number is bigger than one, every negative number is smaller than one. So negative numbers decrease, positive numbers will increase. Yeah. So the positive numbers will be bigger than one after taking the exponent, and the negative ones will be smaller than one. And we get a decrease. But never, only at one we have a straight line, and otherwise we have this curvature. Okay, this is basically already what I told you. The deviance minus the residuals divided by the null deviance gives you some sort of deviance explained by the model. Now we look at this part. Let's see what time it is. Okay. Maybe this is a good point to have a short break. Yeah, because now we go to quite some little bit extra theoretical level, yeah, which is needed for the interpretation and reliability of the model. So let's start again a quarter past. Yeah, 10 minutes break.
How are you?
I will try to get a tea, by the way.
Like a trouble? You really want to know?
So much time. It's been like a month. I think I'll just open my own agency at this point. I know everything about property. So frustrating.
Ja.
Want het verhaal begon met de persoon Ishamin Burns.
Mm-hmm.
En je residual deviance is in feite je
hoofd.
Je residual deviance is je project.
Ja, dat is andere, het is eigenlijk de sum of squares.
Maar dan heb je dus, als ik 1000 metingen doe, in plaats van 60, dan verspringt het ook een gemiddelde naar 1000. Dat is het waar?
Nee, de gemiddelde niet. Je deviance.
Maar gemiddelde is de variatie in de persoon.
Ja, ja, ja.
Dat is toch raar?
Nee, kijk.
Je hebt je model. Je hebt hier je slotvariabelen. En dan heb je de vaste of zo. En dan heb je de data. En dan heb je de rest van mijn rijden. Deze variatie, dat is je nodig. En die was net iets van heel groot geweest. Ja,
Yeah, and I might be just.
the text that I made, I think it's necessary to the text that I tried to do something. So I was looking for the only information that I had. Yeah, I mean, I need to call them. They said that probably if you don't have it, you can send it to the text system. And they'll get it back to you.
I'm going to go to the hospital.
Let us slowly proceed. I had an interesting, ladies at the front, I had an interesting conversation, which actually I almost fell into a trap there. The question, and I will say it now because the person in question is filling his cup.
So I don't want to wait for him.
Ah, he's back.
The question was, how is it possible, you know, that this degrees of freedom would increase if you, so if you have more observations, then that something here should go wrong, right? Because you said, well, your lambda would be the same as expectation value, and you say you get a good fit as degrees of freedom is the same as the residuals, the residual deviance. But if you get more information, more data, then this part will increase also, right? Because you just add more observations to your error, so it will increase. Yeah. So that was a discussion. Now, actually, I started on the wrong footing by thinking in terms of ordinarily squared, that just you know, summing up over all these elements, and then indeed, in that regime, he was right. Then this would not work. But now we come at the moment that exactly marks the difference between maximum likelihood method and ordinarily squared. Because what does the maximum likelihood do? And I have to go back there because nobody can see it here online. We saw that if you have a Poisson distribution and you start at a low expectation value, then you get something like this. If the expectation value, so the y-axis, if you start moving there, then it got broader and broader and broader. So we said, if you had a good fit, then the expectation value would be the same as the variance. That's another thing that's saying the residual deviance is the same as the degrees of freedom. Yeah? But they are somewhere related. They are somewhere related, and they are related, and I will not go into detail there, by the chi-square test. Because the chi-square test is actually a test for goodness of fit. Yeah, if you have a 50-50 sex ratio, yeah, and that's your assumption, your theory, your expectation value, and you observe indeed a 50-50 sex ratio, then you get the chi-square value of zero. And if there's a deviance from that, then the chi-square value will increase. So it's actually a goodness of fit. And if you have the same values of your residuals and your degrees of freedom, then basically if these values are the same, it's a sort of a goodness of fit criteria. I will not go into detail here, but I will show you, and I hope that for you that will also explain a little bit better what's going on, is what is happening if the assumptions that we have, that we should expect a variance of lambda, if that's not correct, that there is more variance there. And how can we observe that? When the residual variance is bigger than the degrees of freedom of the residuals. Yeah? Okay, let's keep that in mind, because we do a maximum likelihood fit. So we fit the data with a Poisson distribution. And for a Poisson distribution, the mean is the variance. That's it. Mean is variance. He cannot change that. That's just the way it is. So all the statistics that you see here, for instance, the standard error, is based on the variance, lambda. So it means if I have more variance, then this would be the standard error, which is something to do with the standard deviation divided by the square root of n. Yeah. Then this would be an underestimate of the standard deviation, of the standard error. Because actually I have a higher standard error, but I used, for the calculation of this, I used the lambda that is fixed, because that's my algorithm, maximum likelihood fit. So if I have overdispersion, if I have more variance than I should, yeah, because my model is incomplete, or I have extreme values in the sense of outliers that would inflate my variance, and therefore I don't get the variance that I want, I get overdispersion. Yeah? Then this would be an underestimate of my standard error, because it's directly calculated from the variance. Yeah? But this standard error I use to calculate the Z value. So basically, because I have here a smaller one than would have been the case, I get an inflation, a smaller p-value.
Okay, let's go through that step by step. Okay, so where were we? Here. So this, we have here the residual deviance and the degrees of freedom. We see here the degrees of freedom of my model. To calculate the null deviance, I have to use one expectation value, namely the null deviance is the variance that I observe for the whole number of counts, so for the response variable, without looking at any model. So there's no model that explains some variance. So the null deviance is basically the deviance of the residuals of my null model. Basically, I only calculate one intercept. And the calculation of that one intercept will cost me 1 degree of freedom. And you get this 71. So the number of observations that I have in my data is 72. Yeah? Now, I have, I have three intercepts and therefore three slopes. So it means my model has 6 degrees of freedom. Yeah? Three intercepts and three slopes for the three treatments, control and yeah. So 72 minus 6 is 66. Yeah. Okay. So this is how that part works. If So now we go to the second part. So this is what I told you what will happen if we get over dispersion and under dispersion. So this is what basically a good fit would look like and what the model assumes that it's the case. Now what if the variance of what if my model was incomplete or I had outliers? Then the residual deviance will just inflate, will become bigger and bigger and bigger. So it means my model doesn't fit well because it doesn't fit the outliers. That's one of the criteria of outliers. Outliers you could not fit because it's actually not part of the population of interest. Yeah. Or my model is incomplete. I should add something to my model in order to explain that residual variance that resulted in this residual deviance to be bigger. Yeah. So I can do that by adding something to my model. I can make it smaller. Okay. So if the residual deviance, if I divide it by degrees of freedom, if that is one, yeah, under the null hypothesis, which follows the chi-square distribution, yeah, then it means I get a good fit. And that is called basically the dispersion parameter. The dispersion parameter is residual deviance divided by degrees of freedom. If that is one, I get a good fit. Yeah? If it's bigger than one, the residual deviance is bigger than the degrees of freedom, and I get over dispersion. Yeah? This means the variance of the residuals is greater. We should explain more due to outliers. And as a result, we get a underestimate of the standard error. The standard error should actually be bigger, but we calculated the standard error based on the lambda, and we get a type 1 error. There's an increased probability of a type 1 error. That's why we need to take this into account. So every time when you go to a more advanced method, there's always something to take into account, an additional thing to take into account. Here is the over-dispersion. You can also go the other way around. If you have a non-significant element in your model, that non-significant element only means that it has a p-value that's bigger than 5%, because that is statistical significance. It doesn't mean that it doesn't explain anything. Every element, if I would put in this model the position of the sun, yeah, which I think should not have any influence whatsoever on the number of spikes in this experiment, yeah. If that's the case, I can put it in. I still find that the sun will explain part of the variance by accident. So if I would put the sun in, then my model would explain more than it should by accident, and I get under dispersion. And that would go the other way around. Then it means that the expected standard error that we get from our fitting of the model relation to the lambda being the same for the mean and the variance would be a overestimate, and the real p-value should actually be smaller than we would get, we would expect. But that, of course, should not be a problem because we want to take out all these non-significant effects. However, sometimes you can make a type 1 error. You put in a in reality non-significant element, but by accident you keep it in because it has a p-value smaller than 5%. You always have that probability there because you have your alpha of 5%. It means that you have something in your model that should not be there, and therefore your model explains more than it should, and you get under dispersion. Yeah? Okay. Now what happens, if, for instance, the number of observations would increase? Yeah, I get more observations. Then, of course, this will increase. I become bigger. But my residual deviance would also increase. Yeah, so they increase together. This is also true, of course, for my degrees of freedom of my model. It will increase. But also, my residuals, because I just have more residuals, will also increase. But if they increase in the same amount, then I still have this balance, this dispersion parameter of 1, and I got a good fit. That's the idea. Yeah? So it doesn't matter how much observations that you have. So you see that they are related, the degrees of freedom and the relation between them. That's the relation is via the chi-square test, that they should be the same. And this means that we have a sort of internal goodness of fit measure, which is the dispersion parameter. Yeah? Which is always 1 because this it grows with the number of observations. Okay. Let's look at some. Let's experiment a little bit with this. This is the fun of course, with this. That say that I had this good fit, which includes the interaction term and all that stuff. Yeah, I have everything in it. Now, let's assume that I took out the idea that I had any treatment whatsoever. So I take out the interaction term, and I take out the factor. Yeah. So I just have a linear regression. I try to fit my model with 1 line. That would, of course, increase the size of my residuals, because the part that is explained by the interaction term and the different treatments, that part that it could be explained by them, is now transported to the residuals, because the right-hand side and the left-hand side in terms of variance should be the same. Yeah. So this means that we get an inflation of my residual deviance. Yeah, it becomes smaller. You see that this will also increase, of course, because I took several elements out. I only have now 2 degrees of freedom in my model, 1 intercept and 1 slope. Yeah, therefore I go to 70, from 72, the number of observations, to 70. But this increase of degrees of freedom is dwarfed by the increase of the residual sum of residual deviance. Yeah. So this is a case of overdispersion. And then if you look at the dispersion parameter, that would be just this value divided by 70, and you get this overdispersion parameter. Yeah? And you also see that the IC has increased. Let's see. It increased from this level, which is really smaller, to this level. So also from the perspective of the IC, the fit is worse. Yeah. So we have all these different links that are linked together. Now, I could argue, well, is this statistically different? Is this statistically different? Well, I think most of you would say, well, they're quite big in terms. But we can test that by using a chi-square test. With a chi-square test, I put the number here, both numbers here, if they are the same, then it would not be significant, and you get an extremely small p-value, meaning that that's a significant overdispersion, and we have to deal with this, because it means that the p-value that I observe is much smaller as it should be. And with over dispersion, you get much smaller p-values. So there's always an increased type 1 error. And this can be very drastic. So for instance, people that come to consult with a stat lab, they are very enthusiastic because they found this and this and this and this using a GLM. Then we discover over dispersion, we find the source of the over dispersion, we take it out, and everything is gone. Nothing is significant anymore. Which you could also see normally from the graph that you plot. So that's why we always combine these two elements. Yeah? So we can also compare them, these two models. The model with over dispersion, of course, and the model with that fitted well with an ANOVA test. This LRT is a likelihood ratio test. Yeah, it's something that you have to do. This is an addition that you have to do, or you can put also in a chi-square test here. These are the two tests that you need to do for the ANOVA comparison. And then you also see that they are significantly different. So you can use also this method to see that, you know, you have this difference between the models. Although this basically gives you the amount of probability that you have over dispersion. Yeah? Okay, so let's look at these points here. This is my summary of my model with only concentration, and you see this gigantic small p-values. And if you remember the original data that we had, it has bigger values. Yeah, I mean, as bigger p-values, not the extremely small ones. Now, if I only so look at, for instance, at concentration here, it has. If I only look at concentration here from the control, it didn't even have significance. Only the two treatments had a significant rate of change. Yeah. In theory, it is, but you don't, with the IAC, you don't know if it's a good fit. You could compare two models that did not fit correctly.
Yeah.
Yeah? So you need to check for this over dispersion. Yeah. So if you compare it with compared with these p values, it's totally different. Now you see how drastic this can be. Now, one way is to use dispersion, dispersion parameter, and add it to your summary model, and then it will compensate. And then you will see that the standard errors are now inflated. They are becoming bigger to basically show that the real residuals are also, has also a higher variance. Yeah? So you see this will increase. The Z value will decrease because you divide by a bigger standard error, and the P values will decrease. And of course, you still see that they're highly significant because it still has this enormous amount of variance that goes up. Yeah, and but now it has it says quasi-Poisson family taken, the dispersion parameter is taking this value. Yeah. This is how you can solve it in this way. So if you cannot solve it because you cannot extend your model or there are no outliers, which is quite normal because in reality you cannot measure everything, especially if you are in the field. So in the assignment of today, I don't think you can make it today, but there's the Galapagos, but I will post the solution to it online anyway. There's a Galapagos island data set where they look at the number of endemic and invasive species under the certain positions of these islands within the archipelago. Yeah. Now you can imagine that the size of the island and the height of the island and the distance from the nearest island, that is not really a complete picture of the complexity of endemic species versus species that are introduced. But therefore, your model is always incomplete, and therefore you always have over dispersion, and then you have to deal with it in this way, in this fashion. You can also do it in a little bit easier way to say, okay, instead of Poisson, I use quasi-Poisson. And what quasi-Poisson actually does is to allow to change the variance of the Poisson distribution again. by actually calculating this dispersion parameter and compensate for it. Just see here this line. Dispersion parameter of the quasi-Poisson is taken to be 3.04. And if you compare it with this one, with our hand calculation, yeah, then you get a similar thing. So that basically means we compensate in order to allow for a bigger standard error, which is more in line with the data that we have. Yeah. The rest, this stays the same. You still have over dispersion here, but at least you compensate it by increasing the standard error. Yeah. Now you also see the t-value recurring. You see that we went from the z-test to the t-test. Why? Because we don't use the lambda anymore, the lambda that is fixed, and therefore we could use the z-statistics. Now we added our own interpretation of the variance by introducing the dispersion parameter, then we get the t-test again. So you see how precise these statistics deal with these different types of perspectives in the problem. Yeah? In many cases, it doesn't really change so much, t of z, but here, in terms of overdispersion, it has a profound effect on the p-values. Yeah? You see that this value is also a little bit smaller, but it, of course, makes use of a more advanced method to calculate the dispersion parameter. It does it directly, basically, in the maximum likelihood fitting procedures. That's why it's a little bit better. The downside is that you don't get a ISA value. You cannot calculate the ISA value for a quasi-Poisson. But you can still do the ANOVA comparison. That's something that you still can do. Yeah. Okay, now let's do the same thing, but then for the square root. Remember, we had this log link function, but we also had the square root link function. This is the result of the square root link function. So why do I want to start first with what is called the canonical link function, this is the log link function? The reason is that I can explain that one as the rate of change, because I only need to calculate, take the values that I estimated and take the exponent from that. Then I get my rate of change. There's a clear interpretation. But if I have a square root, then it means that if I go back, I get the cube. Yeah? The cube of it, but not exactly the cube. Also, the cubic equation, actually. You get a cubic equation, which is harder to give an interpretation to. It's still a rate of change, but this rate of change is not so steep as the exponent, because an exponent is the exponential function, as an exponent of 2.73 and a lot of other numbers, whereas the square has only a 2. So it grows a little bit less steep. Yeah? And this is exactly, of course, what we also see in our data, as we will see in the next slide, that if we fit with the square root, yeah, as link function, then the curvature is less steep. If we fit with the identity link function, then we fit just a straight line again. Yeah? So basically, if you have a lot of curvature, you have the log. If you have not so much curvature, you want to do the square root. And if you have no curvature, you do the identity for a Poisson. Yeah? Now, which one is better? How could we test which of the two plots fitting methods would be better, the linking function? Who could think of an idea? So we need to something to have like a goodness of fit. And did we have a goodness of fit somewhere in our model, in our output? Yeah, I say could be done, but there's also in the output. There's something in the output that I could use to compare. I say would be one. Yeah.
Sum of
squares. It's not in the output. It's the balance, it's the dispersion parameter. So we look at the dispersion parameter, and we see that the square root link function deviates more from 66 than the log link function. So the log link function just gives me a better fit. Yeah? But as we saw already earlier, they are basically statistically the same. So if you would compare it with an ANOVA comparison, which is normally you have to do with nested models, and now you have the same model but only on different length functions, so it will not work that well. But if you look at the IC, they will be very close to each other, yeah, and not significantly different. So the difference is, because there's also no over or under dispersion for the square root, yeah, they are significantly basically the same. Now here you see that especially the better fit is obtained for the blue line here, for the higher rate of change. If I go to a lower rate of change, the difference between the square root and the log has been decreased already. And if you have a straight line, then basically they are the same. They are exactly both on the same line. Yeah, you don't see the difference anymore. Yeah. Now, when, under which conditions would the square root probably do better? If for the same range, these values go a little bit down, then the curvature will go a little bit down because these values are a little bit less high, so the curvature will be less strong. And then under these conditions, you might try fit maybe better with the square root. But you hope, actually, and you try, you start, if you get a good fit with the log link function, you normally use the log, keep to the log link function. Yeah? Now then the Fisher score, we already discussed. If it's between 4 and 8, it's okay. If it's 15 or bigger, then you should start worrying. Then you could, for instance, redo it, or sometimes you get errors from difficulties to converge after 2,000 steps, something like that. These are typically error messages that are to come together with this high Fisher score. Right? Just fail to converge, fail to find a good fit, basically. Yeah? In other words, fail to find a good fit. Power, and then it's then I stop. So could I do a power calculation on this in a nice way? Did you already do power calculations? Now, if you want to do that mathematically, it's quite tedious to do. Yeah, you have to do for every model, you have to do that anew. It's quite some work, but it's doable. Once you could make an Excel sheet for that, for instance, and you know, change the numbers that you can do for a particular type of model. But you can also do it using simulations. Yeah. Basically, what you do is you compute the statistics using the data model. The model that you fitted, you use to simulate new data based on the fitted model. Then you compute the p-values of all these data, and then you just calculate how many p-values of the number of times that you do the simulations are smaller than alpha. And then you count this number, and that will give you a power. So if I do 100 simulations and I find 80 p-values that are smaller than my alpha, then I get a power of 80, 0.8. That's simple. Yeah? And this is the code. So you could try to experiment with that. First you have to call what is called a placeholder. These are the p-values that I want to do the calculation for the power of. So I say the p-values for concentration, control, and for the intercept of this one, yeah, this value. Make 1,000 empty spots in this variable. So I have a vector of all of 1,000 zeros. Then I run my model. And from my model, I can use the function simulate. And then the objects I want to simulate is my model log, which is this model that I just run. And I do that 1,000 times, and the seed is the set seed, which is normally for the random number generator, the starting point to generate basically random numbers. Yeah. Then basically sim is a data frame of 1,000 columns. So you have 1,000 times these counts that you can fit. So you have done, you have repeated your whole experiment in silico 1,000 times. Yeah. Then I make this for loop from 1 to 1,000. I have this 1,000 columns. Then sim e, take the eth column, yeah, and run my model on it, exactly the same model. Then I extract from my table, from my coefficients,
I extract the p-value for the intercept of this one, and from the control value, remember the slope that we calculated for the control was the p-value was 0.06. Yeah, that's typically a situation that you want to know what the power of your analysis is. Yeah, is it significant or not? It's around that area. Yeah. So this starts to run. E becomes 1. Then it takes the first column, run the model, and from that first column it takes the intercept and the control slope and puts it in the first location of these two variables. So the zeros start to be filled with all of them with 1,000 p-values. Yeah. Then I just calculate the sum of the p-values that are smaller than alpha, say 0.05, and divide it by 1,000. That is a very low power. So less than half of the time, I find an effect of the intercept, which is okay. Yeah, which is okay, because you hope, of course, that if there is no blocker, that you would not see spontaneous bursts. You can always see a burst, it's always a probability, but it's not systematic. Yeah, this is okay. Then, of course, in the control situation, you say the power is low. Okay, the power is low also for the control situation, but this is also what you want. In the control, you don't add the inhibitor. These inhibitors, normally you have to dissolve in some apolar solute, and the apolar solute could affect also the triggering of these pulses, maybe. That's why you have the control. And you also see that you have a very small power, which is okay, because this is you don't want that to be significant. But at least you know that it's not a problem of power that you did not detect an effect. But, yeah, of you actually know. And maybe this is not the right, the best example, but the point is that the power is low. Yeah. So this is a very handy way to that you don't need to do all these hand calculations to calculate the power, because you can calculate the power easily with the function for the t-test. But there you also have a function for in R. But everything more complicated than that, than a simple ANOVA or simple regression, you don't have a standard function for that. And then you have to make it yourself. Yeah? Okay, this is what basically I want to tell you when you know what you can do when you have a GLM. The GLM is a very powerful method, but it's also because it extends the range of the analysis of data that you can do. However, with every more advanced method, you get different problems. So on the one hand, it's nice that you can see that you have a good fit, because the dispersion parameter is 1. But at the same time, it introduced the problem of over-dispersion and the problem of increased type 1 of type 2 errors. Yeah? So that's something that you have to deal with. Well, you have the quasi-Poisson, but if you have the quasi-Poisson, you cannot do ISA comparisons anymore. Yeah, and so you have to do these different methods. That's why when linear regression, we discussed ISA, because ANOVA comparison, we looked at different ways to compare models. We compare also using at the residual deviance, for instance, in order to deal with this selection of the best model with different methods that might still work in a more advanced setting. Yeah. The next thing is that the slopes that we get, because we're still looking at the linear model, we have to give a new interpretation to. Yeah? We need to give a new interpretation to the slope and the differences in the intercept. If the intercept is bigger, it means it has a so much increased effect on the due to the intercept. If the slope, it means that you have the rate of change. Yeah? That's something that we have to take into account. The same is true. The whole story I told you here is true for the binomial situation. The binomial situation might argue, well, wait a minute. The binomial situation distribution has two parameters. It has n and p. Yeah, but n is fixed. That's the number of trials that you did. So you have only p to change. And it turns out that the expectation value is n, p, that's expectation value. But the variance is given by NP times 1 minus P. So the variance and the expectation values are also indirectly linked and fixed by the probability, the expected probability of success or failure. So again, we also have overdispersion. We have to deal with that. The other thing is that now the slope and the intercept is not the rate of change or the normal slope, but are the odd ratios. Yeah, it's the log of the probability divided by minus one the probability. That's the log odds. Yeah? So if you have 50% probability, then there's the 50% probability divided by one minus 50, 0.5. That's 0.5 divided by one minus 0.5. Then you get the log odds of the log of one. Yeah? So that's the way that is done. And of course, if you have a very small probability, then you see that the log odds will, or the odds will increase into infinity. Yeah. So probabilities will be between 0 and 1. Log odds can be between 0 and infinity. Yeah? So these are the different interpretation that should be given at that moment. And of course, if you are in a field where this is, for instance, a standard method, for instance, in toxicology, then you know you are used to the interpretation of what this actually means. But if you are new to it and you come in this field, that people start to talk about these slopes and these intercepts a totally different way, and you think, what's going on? Then remember, it's just a different interpretation. Yeah? Also, if you look at the function of a fit in a binomial, it's a sigmoid, also not a straight line. So again, you get this even more highly nonlinear relations, but still underneath it, you have the linear model. But once you know how to interpret the slope and the intercept, you're good. Yes, it should work. Yeah? Are there any questions? No? So I put a zip file online with the assignments. The first one is a little bit similar to the lecture that I gave. So it's different, but similar. Yeah? Try to do that analysis. Try to play a little bit. Try to induce over dispersion, for instance. And try to see that you also understand the curvature that you observe. If you can make the links with what I told you, for instance, a decreasing or an increasing or a straight line, an interpretation that you can extract that actually from the exponent, from the estimates, then basically you know how to give this interpretation. If your model fits well and you take something out, you should get overdispersion. Yeah? You could test if this overdispersion is significant. You could also get underdispersion. Yeah? It's also possible. But with underdispersion, where is it? Did I get it? Where's the equation? The chi-squared function. No. Here. If you have underdispersion, so if the residual deviance is smaller, then the lower tail should be true. Yeah, that's the only thing. But that's standard for chi-squared tests. Okay, I will be here until at least 12 o'clock. Normally I will be a half hour longer if needed. And well, I don't know where you normally do your assignments. Are you doing it here? Or we also have the room next door. And of course, there's also places around. Where do you normally sit together? Or do you just disperse on the building? Okay. Then I just walk around. Yeah? And I just see how things are going. So I walk around here and also the second floor.
at the first call.
We're not having half one, I'll try.